Yeah, good morning, happy Wednesday. Halfway through the week, but tomorrow we'll be done because film scoring, early week film scoring results for Alphaville will be tomorrow. Very good job. A nice haunting theme. Everyone got that into me beautifully, so we'll see that tomorrow. Hope you enjoyed Lester Young. Very breathy sounding tenor saxophonist. And we looked, since doing that first class, we did look at another one, Stan Getz, because we mentioned him yesterday. If you remember, Stan Getz was very, you know, famous with bossa nova and the world of bossa nova, but also definitely influenced by Lester Young. Today we're going to look at somebody that Jode was really, you know, turned Jode Garcia, a client, turned me on to, you know, hey, let's look at this guy more. So today we're going to revisit and look at the great Ben Webster. Webster. Yes, Jode. American jazz tenor saxophone. We've looked at many tenor saxophone players. I mean, when you think of tenor, maybe Coltrane's probably the most, you know, famous jazz saxophone. So we've gone over these different types of saxophones because, it, you know, same fingerings but different ranges, right? So baritone is the lowest. Then it's tenor, and then it's alto, and it's soprano. So that goes from low to high. So he's in the tenor section. Born in 1909, born the same year as Lester Young. We did a class on Lester Young, beautiful, breathy saxophonist. Lester and Ben are going to have a lot of similarities as well with Coleman Hawkins, who we have yet to do a class on, but Coleman Hawkins was a little bit older than them, just 5 years older or so. So let's leave Faure's home from the south of France and go to Kansas City and let's just visually see. So this is early, this is 1909. So this is when jazz is beginning, right? Tin Pan Alley's going on, Urban Berlin's writing the songs, Jerome Kern's writing the songs. These guys are going to, by the 20s and 30s, along with Duke Ellington, Count Basie, jazz and swing is gonna be taking over, right? So people like Lester Young, Ben Webster are playing with Duke Ellington and their big bands. Then they're going to become soloists, you know. So people kind of say Coleman Hawkins, Lester Young, those were the two camps. Ben Webster tried and successfully did his own sound. So those three sounds were just so distinct, you know. And he really just developed an original style. How did he get that style? I don't know. We don't know how geniuses get their style. It's just sometimes it's brokenness inside or happiness inside. So as a kid, he studied violin and then learned to play the blues on the piano because blues is going on, you know, because that comes from jazz many times in Dixieland. So he was playing the piano and then he switched to tenor saxophone because he fell in love with it. So he played with Lester Young, actually in the Young family band, and starts playing in bands in the 30s. Swing music, right? That's the big thing. So he became a soloist in Duke Ellington's band, so from 1940, and along with Johnny Hodges, who's another saxophone player that we'll talk about. There were a lot of trumpet players around too and a lot of other instrumentalists, but saxophone was it's kind of a newer instrument, you know, maybe just 100 years old or so. So people were exploring the newness of it. Mm-hmm. goes to New York, because you have to go to New York. You know, 52nd Street, we've talked about New York City being, you know, the mecca of all this great jazz. He was a sideman and also, you know, a leader at some point, and worked with Raymond Scott. We talked about Raymond Scott, the really brilliant engineer guy, but, you know, great, had a great jazz band, and wrote all of those really great songs that Carl Stalling would arrange, right, for Warner Brothers cartoons. But Raymond Scott wrote a lot of those songs. So he plays with him. Then in the 50s, plays with Jerry Mulligan, another saxophone player. And they played a club in Los Angeles. This is in the 50s, called Renaissance. But a lot of guys, Eric Dolphy, a lot of these jazz guys, especially with the 60s, why? Because, well, Beatlemania, it's hard to really keep up with that. And by the 60s, it wasn't like jazz was going away, but definitely rock and roll and pop music was becoming more popular. So a lot of these guys went to Europe. Europeans loved jazz. They embraced these guys. And so 64 moves to Europe, mostly spends the rest of his life there, in Scandinavia, so Amsterdam, and then his home was in Denmark, in Copenhagen, until he suffered a stroke in Amsterdam in 1973. So what are you guys hearing? Vibrato, right? The shakiness. It doesn't sound like nerves, though. He's purring with this instrument. Dynamics. Playing loud, playing soft. Very, very much in control of the sound. You hear real, like, just very raw loneliness going on. He's crying almost through the instrument, but crying perhaps tears of joy, tears of sadness. Ballads were just, he's caressing the instrument. He's embracing it. He's creating such a romantic mood. So if you guys ever need to set the mood at, you know, for dinner parties, which you guys throw a lot, put on, you know, you can put on one of his albums. One thing, and this is what kind of kept him not so much in vogue, because he's not like Charlie Parker at all, not like John Coltrane at all. He's not playing fast, up-tempo stuff like that. That's just not his style, and he's creating a really personal sound. So a lot of times, ballads are a good way to express that, those personal sounds. We talked about personal, you know, musicians, artists, they're all personal. Some are more commercial, some can do both. Some are just really into, you know, introspection on their instrument, where they do the talking. The instrument does the talking for them. I think he was a sad man and suffered a lot of loneliness and all that stuff in his private life. So, you know, you can kind of hear it in some of his playing. Tone color too, right? I mean, if you think of the tone of his instrument, very colorful, doesn't sound, because there's vibrato, there's breathiness, there's these things. So he's painting a solo almost in a sense. Broad strokes. We looked at strokes yesterday with Impressionism, Monet, and those strokes. It's cool how you can do that in painting and also in music with your mouthpiece, how you blow into the instrument. And a lot of floating on top. It sounds like he's floating, right? I mean, some of these passages are gorgeous passages where he's floating on top of the notes. Irregular rhythm, sometimes it's kind of that, like, I'm just throwing out ideas as we listen to just his gorgeous tone. One writer said it sounded like a cello sometimes, you know, because his range was low. I mean, tenor has the lower range anyway, but he really embraced that lower tone a lot. I thought, you know, that's a pretty good point. One thing I do love about his playing is his tenderness, very deep tenderness in his playing. Joy, loneliness, all coming out of this instrument. So as mentioned, born the same year as Lester Young, and almost the same kind of lifespan and the same life in the sense of addiction and mood on the saxophone. You know, we looked at the saxophone ranges, but what vibrato, right? Very controlled vibrato, though. Almost sounds like a clarinet in the high register, and then sounds like a cello to me in the low register. But he's playing a tenor saxophone. He's not playing a clarinet or a cello. And so he found his personal style, just like Lester Young, through ballads. Some people really, and Coltrane did this too, and we talked about Coltrane, the ballads album. Some people, they have a lot of time to express themselves when the tempo is slower. Somebody like Clifford Brown, somebody like Johnny Griffin, who also plays tenor saxophone, does not sound like this. Johnny Griffin sounds nothing like Ben Webster or Lester Young. He sounds more like Coltrane. I mean, they're, of course, you know, years later, but the instrument does the talking with Ben Webster. You hear the self-expression that we talked about, the personal style and the broad strokes, right? And floated on top of all these notes, making it sound simple, but a lot of tenderness. I mean, more tender. I think Ben Webster's even more sensitive sounding, don't you think? More intimate and sensitive and more tender than Lester is. Lester can be a little broader sometimes, but they both have this very lovely, lush sound of playing the tenor saxophone. So I wanted to compare and contrast kind of these two great players. And we will talk about Coleman Hawkins at some point. I've been saying that for a long time because he was the other third great tenor player. So, all right, so that's wrapping up this week with jazz saxophonist. And tomorrow, Film Scoring results for Alphaville. So stay tuned. Have a great rest of the day and hope you enjoyed Ben Webster and see you tomorrow. Okay, bye.